Good afternoon, everybody. Could everyone take their seats here, thanks. I'd like to welcome everyone this afternoon. My name is Mike Bunt. I'm the Regional Director for the Otago Southland area, and it's been a real privilege with my band of guys to pray and put everything on to be the feet for the National Board. So we've had a great weekend so far. We've had tremendous anointed music. We've had some tremendous teaching, and it blows me away that the difference between Mark and Selwyn. I see Mark has been a real an exhorter, he's a real encourager, and both really speaking to us in love, and Selwyn has to bring the big stick out a little bit, but it's done in love as well, and because we need a bit of both, don't we? And so we're going to be hearing more of Selwyn this afternoon. I'm really excited, and I hope you are as well, and looking forward to it. I felt the Holy Spirit stir me to read Psalm 33. I'm pleased it wasn't Psalm 119. Yeah. Several years ago, it's a dangerous psalm, really. Down at Punawea, where we have our yearly camp down there, this year it's the end of July. This was prayed out by a couple of people, and then the Holy Spirit just took over for about an hour and a half, and the speaker still hasn't spoken. So I'm not saying that's going to happen this afternoon, but just be with me as I pray. And then we've got a special prayer request. How good and pleasant it is when brothers and sisters live together in unity. It is like precious oil, poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down upon the collar of his robes. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion. For there the Lord bestows his blessings, even life evermore. So I just thank you, Lord, for the blessings that we have had, because we have dwelt in unity, as it says in your word this weekend. Lord, and we're asking now, Lord, we're going to ask for a special blessing here together. We're going to ask for prayer for a granddaughter, Nikita. That's Maureen and Keith's granddaughter. She's 15. She has a heart condition and is due to have her heart scan on Wednesday. But today she's had three seizures and is in Wellington Hospital awaiting a brain scan this afternoon. So could you join me? As we just lift up and we just ask God for his blessing, as we call upon the name of all names, the King of all kings, who can do all things. And we just lift up this child before you now, Lord. We just lift up Nikita before you now, Lord, and we just ask in Jesus' name. It doesn't matter where we pray, Lord, you hear us, Lord. And we are here gathered in unity, and when we are gathered in unity on Radio Rema, we heard all through last week, when we come together committed in prayer and we come together joined together in unity, Lord, you hear our prayers even more so, Lord. So, Lord, we're just asking for a mighty miracle to take place here, Lord. Lord, we're lifting up Nikita before you now, Lord, and we're just asking even now that your Holy Spirit would be upon her, and whatever the problem is in her brain, Lord, and with the heart as well, Lord, we're just asking for a divine miracle to take place and ask for a total healing now in Jesus' name. We'll be having some... thank you, Jesus. I'm just sensing the Lord is saying that maybe somebody's got a word for that girl at the moment. I'm just sensing that. Is there somebody that the Holy Spirit just... Okay. Right here. Thank you, Lord. We just come against that spirit of death now, Lord. We just thank you now, Lord, that with the authority that you give us, we can command that spirit of death off that girl now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. I think we just really now have to believe in faith, and we'll just hand over to the musicians who have really blessed us this weekend as they've led us into the presence of the Lord, and we just look now for about 30 minutes of that. That's what we're looking for, about 30 minutes. And even as the Lord inhabits the praises of his people, he's heard our prayer, and our praises will go to him now as well in thanksgiving.
I think it's rather wonderful just to see here that the first song we're going to be singing is When the People of God Get on Their Knees and Pray, then the Holy Spirit can move in a mighty way. There will be healing, deliverance, and miracles every day when the people of God get on their knees and pray. And so we've just prayed. Yeah. Now we can sing it and believe it.
Yeah, expect a miracle for Nikita as we raise our praises to the Lord. Amen. Let's get on our feet.
When the people of God get on their knees and pray, then the Holy Spirit can move in a mighty way. There'll be healing, deliverance, miracles every day. When the people of God get on their knees and pray, when the people of God read His word, go share the gospel to those who lost their way. There'll be healing, deliverance, miracles every day. When the people of God read His word and know love in vain.
When the people of God sing,
shout and clap their hands, then the joy of the Lord will overflow their land. We'll be healing. When the people of God worship Him every day, then the glory of the Lord will come down and fill this place. There'll be healing, deliverance, miracles every day. When the people of God worship Him every day.
Back to the beginning. When the people of God get on their knees and pray.
When the Holy Spirit can in a mighty way. There'll be healing, deliverance, miracles every day. When the people of God get on their knees and pray. When the people of God read His word and go out in vain. Go share the gospel to those who lost their way. There'll be healing, deliverance, every day when the people of God read His word and go out in faith. When the people of God sing, shout and clap their hands, then the joy of the Lord will overwhelm their land. There'll be healing, deliverance, miracles every day when the people of God sing, shout and clap their hands. When the people of God worship Him every day, then the glory of the Lord will come down and fill this place. We'll be healing, deliverance, miracles every day. When the people of God worship Him every day,
there'll be healing.
There will be healing, deliverance. There it goes every day when the people of God worship Him every day.
Woo! Amen! Amen! Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, into your courts we will enter. Thank you, Lord. We're going to sing this a little bit faster than probably some of you may be used to. It's a real praise song to the Lord.
Your courts I will enter, Maker of heaven and earth. I tremble in your holy presence. Glory, glory in your sanctuary, splendor and majesty, Lord. Before you, all life adores you. All the earth will declare that your love is everywhere. The fields will exalt, seas resound. Ere the trees joyful cry, praising you, so will I. A new psalm I'll sing, Lord, glorify.
Holy are you, Lord, the whole.
about you, Lord.
When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
When the music fades.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. I'm just to breathe something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
King of endless worth.
King of endless worth. No one could express how much you deserve. Though we can. All I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
When the music fades.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your holy, holy.
we've been blessed by Selwyn this weekend, and we've been challenged by Selwyn through the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit, and we're going to be blessed and challenged, no doubt, again this afternoon as well. So Selwyn, would you like to come forward? Just lay your hands out if you can, and we'll just pray for Selwyn as he brings the message. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this anointed man of God, this man that you've used in many, many parts of the globe, and you have brought him not to the uttermost ends, but nearly at the uttermost ends in Dunedin here this weekend, Lord. So we just thank you for that now, Lord, and we just ask that your anointing continue to flow through him. Lord, I'd even ask and be bold enough to ask for a double anointing upon him this afternoon, Lord, a double anointing so that you would be glorified, your name would be lifted high, we'd be challenged, we'd be brought closer to you, Lord, and I ask this in Jesus' name.
It's been a real pleasure and a privilege to be here. Let me just minimize this for a moment because I want to show you something else first. I want to thank of the island as often as I'd like to, although the weather's certainly much nicer today, isn't it? And for which we're most grateful. Part of the world twice in the last year, so maybe the Lord's opening the doors to the south, and that would be good because we need revival here. I think this is the one that works over the intercom, so this is for all the branch presidents here. This is a job description for you.
This man right here is my great grandfather. He's the first cat herder in our family.
Herding cats, don't let anybody tell you it's easy.
Anybody can herd cattle. Holding together 10,000 half-wild short hairs, well, that's another thing altogether.
Being a cat herder is probably about the toughest thing I think I've ever done.
I got this one this morning, right here. And if you look at his face, it's just ripped to shreds, you know?
You see the movies, you hear the stories, I'm living a dream. Not everyone can do what we do.
I wouldn't do nothing else.
It ain't an easy job, but when you bring a herd into town and you ain't lost a one of them, ain't a feeling like it in the world.
EDS, managing the complexities of the digital economy.
Does that look a bit like a branch president's office? I thought you'd appreciate that. Actually, we got time today, haven't we? Yeah. I like pussycats because I serve the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. this one. Hallelujah. You know, some churches that I get to go to, I look around and it looks like everybody's been baptized in vinegar. And sometimes it seems necessary just, you know, God's got a sense of humor. He made each one of us. Hallelujah. As I was saying before, I really want to thank Graham and the team for inviting us. We've had a ball. It's been good to catch up with old friends and make some new ones. And it's all about enlarging the kingdom, isn't it? And that's really why I want to talk about this subject today, because I'm sure that all of you are in perfect health. But I believe that healing in a biblical context is a tool of evangelism. And I noticed Jesus didn't require people to be saying out loud a statement of faith or go and get baptized before he'd healed them. He just healed them. And I believe the disciples' job was to do the follow-up. And we're it. But I think part of what we need to do is do biblical healing. I mentioned this the other day. I love teaching on this because quite often the Lord won't say annoys me, but I remember I was up in Uri, we're at the Baptist church there, teaching on this, trying to think when it was, 2 or 3 years ago now. And when we came to a time of doing some things, the Lord said to say, anybody here with a bad back? And there were quite a number of people put their hands up. And this is... I'm glad it's not my sparring. Oh, the mute was on. Okay. All right. Anyway, I'm demonstrating this is how you pray for a bad back. And the lady gets healed in the middle of showing people how to do it, which is a little annoying because we haven't finished yet. But you know, the Lord in his grace healed 8 people with bad backs who were just watching. And that's happened more than one occasion. So I don't know why we seem to have got sloppy on some of these things. As I think I said on the very first afternoon when I spoke, I believe that in many cases we've grown weary of well-doing. Certainly in the church in New Zealand we have, in large measure. There's not it's either entertainment or we're tired. And I think we need a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. In fact, I'll go further. I can remember, in fact, Mark and I were just talking about this at lunchtime. I can remember when we had sort of charismatic ministries in the early 70s, and then suddenly the denominational barriers went up again, and we had Anglican renewal and Presbyterian renewal and Catholic renewal. And I think we just need renewal. Myself. And I think one of the vehicles that God can use, if you're willing, is Men's Aglow. Well, I'm in trouble now. I'm getting the... Well, you know, the feminine version is Dames Aflame. You all know that. Well, it's such a big mouthful. Do you think you could come up with a slightly more sort of catchy third millennium name? Anyway, I believe there's 2 things that I need to say amongst others, but 2 things that the Lord's impressed on me. And one is there are many of us who need to redig some old wells because we've got tired and we've put the shovel down. And the other thing is there are some of us who we're drinking stale water and we actually need to dig a new well. And the Holy Spirit will show you what that means in your situation. But I believe there is a repositioning of a lot of people in the kingdom for his purpose. And some of you have grown weary because you're just going through motions where you are spiritually. And it's time to stop the treadmill and find the path that he wants you to be taking. Because I think there are several of you
that the Lord is wanting you to take a fresh path. It doesn't mean you're going to not be involved in full gospel businessmen or anything like that. It just means there are some things you're doing at the moment, I sense, are irrelevant to the kingdom. You see, either you're part of the solution or you're part of the problem. And I think that's something we need to look at. If you're wanting a full teaching on this, I'm happy to come anywhere in the country at a time that's convenient and teach this. It usually takes a whole Saturday. Anyway, and we did this last night, so I don't think we need to do it. Well, let me back up here. I'm going to use quite a number of scriptures, and as you'll notice, I do that because I had some very good input one time from a teacher of teachers. And he said, when you speak, people remember about 11% of what you say, but if they see it as well as hear it, they remember somewhere in the high 80%. And that's why I use this method. It works for me, I hope. Although I don't know about Mike saying me carrying a big stick, bludgeon, or what was the word you used? Well, in Scripture it says that God would re-establish Israel in his time and he would send hunters and fishers. And the fishers were the Zionists and the hunters were the Nazis. And that's what it took for Israel to be established on time in God's program. And I can't help feeling that maybe the church in New Zealand probably has a similar issue, and we're at the moment we're still in the fishing stage. But I wouldn't mind thinking that maybe the hunters may be on their way if we don't pull our fingers out, in a manner of speaking. You know what I mean. Anyway, don't take my word for it with the scriptures that we look at. Go and read them, read around them, check the context. You know, I remember Derek Prince saying a text out of context is a pretext. That makes it a lie. We need to read things in their context. It would change some of our thinking and our theology, I believe. It's time to get God's view of things instead of man's. Okay? So, let me make this statement right from the outset. The early church increasingly chose political influence and financial power, and the price they paid was the loss of power to preach the gospel and to heal the sick, including casting out demons. I would appreciate your prayer for something that's coming up on the 4th of July. I'm being interviewed for national radio on the issue of deliverance in the religious, the spiritual program, you know, the one they have all the Masons and things on. And I'm really privileged to be asked to do that because I think it's time that the anti-church part of New Zealand actually understood the church cares enough to do what it needs to do. So I'd appreciate your prayer because I'm assuming I'm going to have a little bit of opposition to that. And I'm looking forward to it. Nothing like a good scrap. I was thinking of getting a t-shirt made saying I survived Kim Hill. I remember some years ago we had a seminar in Lower Hutt, and somebody rang up and I was interviewed on the breakfast program on national radio. And I was told I'd get 3 minutes, you know, between take the news out of the half hour and there's 25 minutes and they try and fit in so many slots. Well, I'm sitting across the table from Kim Hill. And I don't know, she'd just finished grilling Bill Birch. I thought, lambs to the slaughter here. And so she started off her introduction and she said, now, is this just another fundamentalist Christian event? And I said, that's an interesting phraseology you're using. Fundamentalist, that means they believe the basics, like that the Bible is God's word and Jesus died for our sins and so on. I said, I think you meant to use the word fanatical, but you can reason with me. And we got on famously and I got 9 minutes out of the half hour. So, you know, I think sometimes we need to play hardball a little bit in the appropriate way. And I think we need to do our homework well. So, anyway, I've done a little bit of homework on demons, so I should be okay. But I'd appreciate your prayer, because there's an awful lot of pagans are going to listen to it. And I think it's an opportunity to actually have some influence in quite a significant part of the nation. So I'd appreciate that. I'm not bothered whether that's on the tape or not. Probably better not, but it doesn't matter. It is a lie that Christians are powerless. I remember when I first moved to Wellington to be the manager of Radio Rema there, one of the evenings I was listening to Jack Hayford teaching, and he read a document that the Christian leaders of Rome wrote to the Caesar of the time and said, this was in 1988, that he read it over the radio. You probably won't remember that, but he read this document out and they said, we honour you as head of state, but we can't worship you as God because we've already got one, basically. But they said, if you want to tell a real Christian from a pretend one, give them a demonized person, and if they can shift the demon, they're a real Christian. I think that would be a wonderful method of a standard for church membership. We could start with all the religious spirits. I think part of the problem in the Western church today is we've got this Greek mindset. We have to reason everything, we have to see it, and we don't have the element of faith like we ought to. And it explains to me why there are so few miracles in the West compared to when I go to places like Zambia and Africa and some other places, I see miracles on a regular basis. I mention a number of them in the healing manual, for example. Just absolutely amazing things, but they're normal there. I remember the very first time I went to Zambia in August of 2000, and I was to speak several times each day for 4 days on healing and deliverance. They really wanted it power-packed in every direction. And at the end of each day, we would have an altar call for healing. And hundreds of people would come forward, and there was, let me tell you, there were real miracles happen. I saw them with my own eyes. I can't dispute it. I went anticipating God would do something, but I saw a lot more than I expected. And on the fourth night, we gave the invitation, and a whole lot of people came forward, but nobody needed healing. They all came to bring testimony that God had done it. And you know what? I was just there a few weeks ago, and they're still talking about that week. 7 years later, they're still talking about it. That tells me there is a power that should be following us, according to Scripture, and if we will release the Holy Spirit to do what He wants to do, you will see God change your town, your city, your church, and heaven knows, even our nation. Okay? Wolfgang Simpson, who's a Lutheran from Germany, when he was here in June of 2004, said in the third world, the three main ingredients for the significant church growth, and I spoke about that on the Thursday afternoon session and gave quite a lot of numbers and so on, and most of them come out of the Megashift book, which we've run out of here, but we've got plenty back home if you want to order one. He said, healing, deliverance, and prophecy are the three ingredients of revival in the third world, as we would call it. Now, we need to stop being frightened of signs and wonders. I don't serve a dead God, and the living God isn't nervous. Okay? When we do what we're supposed to do, He'll do what He says only He can do. And we need to stop being afraid of demons, evil spirits. Okay? One of the things that I've noticed is there's quite a lot of poverty around the church. And I think often it's a spirit of poverty. I heard a quote recently, I think I've adopted it now. I tried poverty, I didn't like it. I think we need to get rid of it. And the spirit that empowers it, which often comes from the very first degree in Freemasonry, where everything metal is taken from the man before he's initiated. Did you know even his wedding ring? I wonder how many wives of Masons knew that their husbands took their wedding rings off to go through an oath that brought a curse into their family. Now, Jesus has delegated certain authority to his disciples, and we're it in this generation. And it's time, I believe, we got on with the job. And the fastest growing parts of the church, signs and wonders in healing and so on, are normal. Okay, this is normal. It's not just a setting on a hairdryer. Okay. I've noticed in evangelism schools there are three things that seem to be missing. Now, I've spoken in a number of OAC and other schools of evangelism, and I keep thumping them on this, hoping that they'll wake up to it, and I think some of them are beginning to. These are the three ingredients that are missing from evangelism training school. God has a specific approach. Mass evangelism actually produces very little fruit. Did you know that 12 months after Billy Graham's had a crusade in a town or city, only 6% who went forward are still following Jesus? That's an awful lot of effort for very little fruit. We need another way that works. Okay? Secondly, God seems to go to great lengths to bring the right unbeliever together with the right harvester, to use a phrase you'd understand. I know a lot of people who have come from England, from South Africa and other places to New Zealand in order to get born again. Okay? Mark's waving his hand. He's one of them. Okay? And thirdly, God often uses signs and wonders and miracles to demonstrate his power and to convince unbelievers. You see, you can try and reach people intellectually, and there's a few folks that'll work for. But for most people, forget the brain, go for the heart. That's what will change their perceptions. You see, you can talk to them about miracles, but if you demonstrate one, you can't argue with that because you can see what's happened. Somebody was telling me before they were praying for a man who had one leg longer than the other. And who was that was telling me that before lunch? Was it Ron? Okay. And he was saying he prayed for this man and the wife wouldn't even look. But when the legs were lengthened to the same length, because he needed to have built-up shoes manufactured for him, when they prayed for him, his leg lengthened so that they were both the same length. It does happen sometimes. And she said, but his knees aren't even. And they said, well, we didn't pray for his knees, we prayed for his legs. But you see, here's a wife who didn't even want to see the miracle, and all she could do was find fault. You want to be careful about that, because often you get the miracle gets reversed. And God says, well, keep your condition. I've seen God do that on occasions. Okay? So we need to have some power in what we're doing. I think this is a fundamental statement for this weekend, if nothing else. People need to experience God instead of trying to comprehend him. See, when you spend time in the presence of God, you can't argue with him. It's just too obvious what's going on. Now, here's a question for you. Why did Jesus regularly use miracles in front of crowds of people? Anybody got an answer? There is a biblical answer.
If you don't believe the words that I speak, please believe the miracles that you see.
If you don't believe the words I speak, at least believe the miracles you see. That's a chapter and verse. It's okay. Well, the correct answer, if it'll come up, is so people would believe in him. Okay? Like I said before, he didn't require you to recite a creed or to be baptized or whatever before he did ministry. He did the ministry and then there's the follow-up. Give me the privilege of introducing you to your healer. That's a tool of evangelism. Okay? Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians, my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Holy Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Don't get carried away that Mark and I can throw a few words together and they sound good. Be concerned for using God's word as the sword to cut through to the heart of a matter. Okay? Let me summarize. Just for the sake of time this afternoon, I've listed them all in the manual, but I won't go through them all now. But there are 37 recorded miracles of Jesus in Scripture. Some of them are in two or three, and I think there's even a handful of them that are in all four Gospels. But we treat them as one, even if they're in several Gospels. Okay, out of the 37, 16 were just straight-out healings. That's just what he did. I'm glad I don't use Jesus' methods totally. He spat in one man's eye. I haven't felt led to do that yet. I'm not sure I would feel particularly comfortable, but if he said it, I guess we've got to do it. Okay? There were 8 expulsions of demonic spirits. Let me mention this right here, because I'm not really going to spend any time today talking about demons, but let me say, Christians could not do exorcism. And the reason is exorcism is a pre-Christian magical ritual that involves putting a demon in to suppress symptoms caused by a lesser demon. That's not freedom. So Christians cannot do exorcism. I know that's a term used in some parts of the church, but it's a wrong term. Deliverance is the term most of us use, but deliverance actually has a meaning beyond, it means freedom, I think, in its foundational meaning, but it's a term beyond just evicting demons, okay? Although that's the term that we've adopted. Okay? There were five provisions of fish and chips or money. Okay? He raised three from the dead. And he did one each of turning water into wine, disappearing, calming a storm, walking on water, and cursing a fig tree. So let me ask this question. How many of you have done any of those in the last week? Now, if you've got teenagers, they'll do the disappearing one when it comes time to do the dishes or load the dishwasher. But that's probably about the only one. I think we were talking before lunch about pastors' job descriptions and how they have to walk on water. We've misplaced the fivefold ministry, I think, in the church. We need to find it. Now, this is the disturbing passage for us right now. Jesus not only healed the sick, but he committed that same ministry to his disciples. In Mark chapter 6, he called the 12 to him. He sent them out two by two and gave them authority over evil spirits. They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. Well, now you've gone quiet. How many of you have ever baked a cake? Come on, honesty. How many of you have ever baked a flop? It's confession time. You know the ones where you throw them outside and the birds peck them and then they can't fly afterwards? All right. Well, I want to give you several, very briefly, several healing recipes from Scripture that will give you some principles you can act on. Because I'm assuming that if most of you are involved either in a local church or in a chapter of Full Gospel Businessmen or a GLOW or something similar, and even if you're not, even if it's a house church or whatever, that you will go and demonstrate this on a regular basis. It becomes a lifestyle. Okay, you want to grow your church or your chapter or whatever, this is what will help do that. You'll have people who will oppose you. Well, they're the religious people, usually. Ignore them and get on with the job. Okay, as best as you can. Okay, so here's Mark chapter 16, the very end of that book of Mark. Jesus said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And these signs will follow those who believe in my name. They will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. If they drink anything deadly," that'll be the coffee, "it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover." Now, there's three things we learn from this above all. Three basic ingredients. One is preaching the gospel. Let me say this. Make it relevant. I said this earlier in the weekend. Preaching the gospel means making it relevant. If there's just two of you talking, you don't have to march up and down your kitchen waving your Bible around and shouting. You'll frighten the horses. Okay? Secondly is lay hands on the sick. Jesus said to do this and he did it. And thirdly, it says they shall recover and you're only responsible for the first two. God will take care of the third one. Okay? So, two verses further on, it says this, "They went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming through the accompanying signs," amen, or as the Old King James says, "through signs following." Isn't that the sort of life you would like? When I gave my testimony in some measure yesterday, I have to tell you, and I sort of said it, but I want to repeat it now. I'm just a little boy from Otago who prayed a dangerous prayer, "Lord, I'm available." I could never have imagined the places the Lord has taken me. I could never imagine the places I'm still to go to. When I was with Bishop Bill Hammond in Florida in February of this year, before he let me in the pulpit, he wanted to pray for me. We'd never met before. Somebody stuck a tape recorder in front of him, and he started praying, and it typed up at 4 pages of prophecy. And I tell you what, there's some scary things in there. Because he's made the statement universally, not just for me, that the problem with prophecy is it tells you where you're going, but not how you're going to get there. And we need to start thinking about that. Okay, so let's not worry about it. Preach the gospel with an appropriateness. Do you know what? When I finish teaching on healing, there's such an anointing because I use so much scripture. People get healed whether I've got the faith for them or not. That's what I've thought about it. I've thought about it with Benny Hinn when he comes around. Benny's not special. He puts his trousers on one leg at a time too. Okay? He's no Superman. Well, Superman wears his underwear on the outside. What confidence could you have in a man who can't get dressed properly? But you know, when Benny comes to places like he's coming to New Zealand next week, or this week, sometime this week anyway, when he goes there, I've thought about this quite a bit. I mean, Benny's just a man who prayed a dangerous prayer, I guess. Don't agree with everything he's ever said. Some of it I think is probably a little too near heretical. Doesn't matter. The bottom line is when he goes there, because people come with faith, the faith accumulates into such a mass of energy of God, and I don't mean that in a New Age sense, people just get healed spontaneously anyway. Benny might as well not even show up, just advertise his name, and they'll come prayed up, ready to see something. Can you hear what I'm saying? It's not flesh and blood that does this. This is the supernatural being released because we're obedient to God's word. That's what we need to understand, okay? Now, here's an example, laying on of hands. Jesus did it. I remember doing this the very first time I was in Zambia back in 2000. Jesus laid hands on a lady who was bent over. They brought me a lady who literally, you could put a tray with cups on her back. She was bent over. And I said to Pastor Wellington Mfasi, who was translating for me, I said, Wellington, what legal ground has she given Satan for her affliction? Because there's almost no other reason for her to look like that. And he asked her some questions in the local dialect, and I said, firstly, how does she not tip over on her nose? I mean, that was the first question that occurred to me. And her answer was, I'm tired of looking at feet. What was the legal ground? Her Pentecostal pastor went to the witch doctor for herbs for her. Legal ground. And I said, is she willing to renounce the witch doctor and the herbs? We'll deal with the pastor separately. And Wellington asked her, and she said, yes. So he led her through a prayer. He'd been translating for me. He knew what to say. He led her through this prayer. I anointed her. No, I didn't anoint her with oil. We commanded, you don't use oil for demons, okay? Just by the way. You use that for healing, but not for demons. We commanded the demons out of her, and she stood up and ran around, and there was a lot of noise in the place. And I said, Wellington, do you know where this lady lives? And he said, yes, she's about 2 blocks from my house. And I said, can you take a posse around there first thing tomorrow morning and burn everything from the witch doctor and pray through and cleanse her house? Do it properly. And he said, I will very happily do that. And I said, now when you finish that, would you go and visit her pastor? And tell him, the next time he does this, I will visit him. See, I carry a certain mana in there. So, you know, you walk softly, but you carry a big stick. Well, maybe you're right, Mike. I don't know. Yeah, well, careful. So, I know that this scripture is true because God did it under my hand. Notice I said God did it. Okay? This is a verily, verily, if you were reading the Old King James, which means it's important, get your ears on. Jesus said, this is one of my favorite scriptures. Mark mentioned two or three of his this morning that really sort of encapsulates a part of his belief system of ministry. This would be one of mine. Jesus said, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, you will do also, and greater works these you will do because I go to my Father. Jesus only raised three people from the dead in his whole ministry. Benson Idahoser, a Presbyterian from Nigeria, raised nine from the dead in one sitting. Well, I suppose that's a lying, actually, isn't it? Hadn't thought about that before. Okay? So this scripture is true. You've heard about Benson, haven't you? I'm sure Mark must have heard about him. Have you heard of Benson? He's a Presbyterian. He's been to New Zealand. Presbyterian Renewal brought him out here during the 80s, I think. Benson Idahoza. Yeah, from Nigeria. Do you know, when he got saved, he read the scripture and he said, I know what I got to do. And he went round, knocked on doors. Has anybody died here today? I mean, what an opening line. Do you know, the first eight bodies he prayed over, nothing happened. I think God was just testing, are you going to be faithful regardless of the results? The ninth one was raised from the dead. Okay? He didn't know more than the Scripture and the Holy Spirit. Well, what do you know? Acts 1:8, this is another one that sort of summarizes my ministry. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and all the way to Invercargill. Never gonna. I can cancel an invitation there, can't I? Okay, do you see what he's saying? Without me, without the Holy Spirit, rather, you can't do much. You can pretend. You might even be able to do some soulish stuff. But without the Holy Spirit, you don't have what it takes to heal the sick or raise the dead. Okay? And in Matthew 10, Jesus said, as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's actually a crucial line. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely you've received, freely give. We've ministered with a lot of people who have been healed and they offer you money and I just say, well, you can put it in the offering, but you can't pay for this. Jesus forbids it. Okay? You see, we need the power of God. If I was at home, because I was on the plane, I didn't have room for it, but if I was at home teaching on this, I've got a car battery and I hold it to my chest and I say, this is like the Holy Spirit in us. We need the power. And our hands become like jumper leads. Do you get the picture? Because that's really what happens. It's not you, it's the Holy Spirit in you, and if he's not in you, you've got nothing to give. Now, one of the things, let me say this, half the time I don't feel anything. I'm praying for somebody and I'm thinking, Lord, I just want to lie down, I'm tired. And I don't feel anything. I'm probably being very irreligious. Oh, well, who cares? Not being very spiritual, and yet they get healed anyway, and it's not because I've got anything except the Holy Spirit chooses to do it. And half the time nothing, I don't feel anything. Sometimes I feel tingling, or the Lord will give me a little picture in my mind of what it is. Like last night I prayed for several people and the Lord said something about a particular part of their body, you know, and I was just perhaps put my hand on their chest or something with a couple of the guys, and the Lord shows me a blockage in the heart, and I'm saying, okay, so I spake it out to them, and I find out they've had heart problems, or whatever. So be open to the Holy Spirit to give you some indication of what are you doing. Okay, it's not hard. Okay, so the Holy Spirit, and I don't want to diminish the Holy Spirit, to call him a car battery would seem irreligious or disrespectful, and he knows I don't mean it that way. Okay, but I'm trying to get a picture across to you that you understand how this operates. Where do you put your hands? Well, we always do things with decency and in order. One of the problems we have in the church today is we've got too many secret agents for Jesus instead of ambassadors for Christ. Ambassadors do things with dignity and decorum. And ambassadors are sent with the full authority of their government. Isn't that true? So therefore, we do things with authority. Okay, so usually I'll put my hand on the head or their shoulder or somewhere that's appropriate. If it's a woman, I would normally grab either my wife or one of the elders' wives or pastor's wives, and then we can run along the row. Okay? The Lord taught me that right at the beginning. It makes life just so much easier. Now, last night was a little different, but as a general rule, if we're doing healing, particularly at a sort of front of church situation, I would grab one of the ladies from the church, one of the leadership women, and say, you're not allowed more than a meter from me because you're my witness of what I'm saying. So if somebody says to some person in authority, he told me to give up my medication, I never would say that, because that's practicing medicine without a license, and you can do jail time for that. You never tell anybody to give up their medication. If they say, now I had somebody come to me about 3-4 years ago now, after I'd been doing some teaching, and they said, God's healed me. Now, this person had had a liver transplant. They're on drugs for the rest of their life unless God intervenes. I know that. And they said, God's healed me. I don't need my medication. That's a death sentence if it's presumption. And I said, you go back to your doctor, you tell your doctor what you think, and you let your doctor regulate your body coming off anti-rejection drugs, and if it doesn't work, you better get back on them pretty quickly. But that's your doctor's call, not mine. You see, we need a little wisdom with this. People have died in New Zealand because of presumptuous Christians who have been sloppy in understanding this whole concept. Okay? So we do things with dignity and common sense. As for anointing with oil, I could spend an hour just talking on James 5. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church. Let him pray over them. Anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith shall save the sick. The Lord will raise him up. And if he's committed sins, he'll be forgiven. That's a reasonable package of information there. Okay, maybe this needs to be preached in a few more pulpits in the country. I can't find anywhere in Scripture where if you're not an elder, and a pastor's just an elder that's on staff usually, I can't find anywhere where if you're not an elder, you should use oil. But I can't find anywhere that says you shouldn't either. Okay? So it's really up to you. If you want to use oil, I would go to whoever you're spiritually accountable to, your pastor or whatever, and say, would it be all right when I'm praying for healing if I use some oil? It's just a protocol of being accountable. Now, if you're a flaky type person, they're probably going to say no. Don't then be in rebellion. Okay? So this is an important thing, that we just do things in order. When you're accountable for your ministry, let me tell you, you will achieve a far greater measure than if you just try and do it on your own. Let me tell you, lone rangers do a lot of damage and they don't last long. Okay? We've got too many lone rangers in the church. Okay? Now, it's interesting, the Anglican Church in New Zealand, some dioceses, the bishop has to give you a certificate permitting you to use oil if you're ministering in Anglican churches. And yet other dioceses, they don't have any such rule. It's up to the local vicar, for example. So there's different rules in different parts of the church. So just be alert to that if it's an issue for you. Okay, the third ingredient, they'll recover. It doesn't say healed instantly. Okay? This is what I've discovered. This is a revelation. A miracle is a fast healing, and a healing is a slow miracle. This isn't rocket science, folks. I remember I was in Orangeville in Ontario, Canada. It's about 90 minutes north of Toronto Airport, roughly, just sort of basically straight north. And I was ministering there at a residential place for 3 days some years ago. And the evening session finished with doing a bit of healing ministry one particular night. And this lady presented herself, and I said, what do you need from the Lord? And she said, I've been deaf in my right ear for 30 years. She said, it was convenient. My husband snored. But she said, he died a year ago, and I don't need to be deaf anymore. So we dealt with a little issue that I think was part of the blockage. And I walked around her and I spoke to her in a lowish voice, even though there was a bit of background noise. And I said, I was just talking to her and saying, are you hearing anything different as I walk around you, just one ear from the other? When I got back in front of her, she said something very important. She said, I don't perceive any difference, but I thank the Lord for what he's begun. That's a statement of faith. So we acted on that. Now, Next morning at breakfast, she comes over to my table and she says to me, "Do you know, I reckon my hearing's about 10% restored overnight." And I said, "Well, keep an attitude of gratitude. Keep thanking God for what he's done and what he's still doing." Now, I was back in Canada about 5 months later, down near Ottawa, where Anne comes from, and I was teaching on this in another retreat centre in the Ottawa Valley, and I happened to mention this lady in terms of what she said. And there was a couple seated right on the front row, and they got quite agitated, and I said, "Is something wrong?" And they said, "Oh, we know her." And they told me her name and where she lived and everything. And I thought, "Well, that's nice to know." And I said, "Well, how is she?" And they said, "She just had her hearing tested last week, and it's 100%. I don't care if it took a few months. Obviously, God didn't. So, you know, the speed is not the issue. The direction of improvement is the issue. Okay. I need to say this to you too. Jesus said in Mark 11, "Therefore, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them." Now, I don't have time today to get into the issue of the sin of presumption, but presumption is saying what God hasn't said. So you need to check out what it is he's saying. There's plenty of detail in the manual on it that I don't have time to get into today. Okay? Faith is standing on God's word, trusting him regardless of what you see. Okay. Remember the scripture. This is another one of those foundational scriptures. Jesus said in John 15:5, "I am the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing." Okay? So, can we heal? Well, in one scripture, Paul gets the credit, and another, Philip gets the credit, and another, Peter gets the credit. And the bottom line is, they got the credit, but it wasn't them. It's the Holy Spirit through us. Okay, so don't get a swollen head that you can heal the sick. We're actually all supposed to be doing that if we're disciples of Jesus. This is a servant attitude we need, not a bossy one. Okay, here's the second healing recipe. This comes from the book of Acts, chapter 3. You'll know the passage. "Silver and gold I have none." This is the man who was crippled, paralyzed. "But what I do have," Peter said, "I'll give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, and praising God, as I'm sure you would. Okay, what do we learn from this? There's four ingredients in this. Firstly, it's releasing power in the name of the one who does it. If you get a Mexico City phone book, you'll find a lot of people called Jesus. You need to wing the white number. Okay? Just a few verses further on, Peter had to say to the religious leaders, "It's through faith in his name has made this man strong." The faith that comes from Jesus, in other words. So we need to be specific. You can use whatever name you like that you're comfortable, but use a little more than Jesus. Name of Jesus Christ, because that's his title. Christ means Messiah. His real name is Yeshua ben Yahweh. Okay? In fact, if you're doing deliverance and the demon won't go, use his real name, and I'll tell you what, you'll have immediate success. Almost every time, a coconut, as we would say. Oh, that's a Samoan saying, isn't it? Thank you, Martha. Okay? So remember whose name it is. Nazareth just identifies that there's only one of those. Delegated authority. Now, who's the head of state of New Zealand? Well, I'm meaning in political authority. Technically, it's Elizabeth I, Queen of New Zealand. Because she's Elizabeth II of Great Britain, but she's the first Elizabethan queen we had. Okay? She comes once every 5 years. So she has a Governor General, and he can't do everything. Need to pray for him. He's a good, godly man. How on earth he ever got the job, I'm surprised. But he's a good, godly man. Know that from pastors who know him in Wellington. The Prime Minister is delegated, having won more seats in the election than because of what we do. You know, we get the government we deserve. I didn't realise we'd been that bad, but anyway. You could say that regardless of party, actually. The Prime Minister can't do everything, and so she has a Minister of Police and a Minister of Defence, and their job is internal and external security. And they can't be everywhere, so the Minister of Police delegates it down through the Commissioner, right down to the policeman who stops Graham for speeding down the highway from Napier. Now, I've just tracked down the authority order, and the policeman stops, puts out his hand, and Graham could run him over. But that hand has authority behind it. All the way right back to the entire police force, if necessary, they will pursue him until they capture him. So when a man steps out in a uniform, in a policeman's uniform, and says, stop, we usually stop, don't we? Americans don't seem to. I watch some of those things on TV. Why they think they can get away with it, I'll never know. I suppose the odd one do, but they must be so high on drugs or something. Let me tell you, there's no high like the Most High.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Anyway, delegated authority. Jesus has given us all a sheriff's badge to use his name with his authority. That's the key issue we need to understand. And he says, I'm giving you authority over all the power of the enemy. Now, we sometimes struggle with, well, what is the serpents and scorpions? Because we don't have either of those in New Zealand. Well, it's usually understood to refer to the demonic realm, but I think that's probably a little limiting. But nothing shall by any means hurt you. Okay, when we have that authority, we use it appropriately. Second ingredient, God commands. Peter said, rise up and walk. God said, let there be light in Genesis 1:3, and there was light, and he didn't make the sun for another 4 days. Okay? You hadn't connected the dots on that, maybe. Jesus went to Lazarus's funeral after dithering around for 4 days. There's a reason for that, I believe. And Jesus said, take the stone away, and I think, was it Martha said, it stinks. But they took it away anyway. And Jesus says this little prayer, and then he says in a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he came first. Do you know why Jesus waited for 4 days to go and interrupt the funeral? Because the Jews of the time had a belief that the spirit hung around the body for 3 days in case it was called back into the body, but at the fourth day it had gone. Jesus was showing that he had power over death by that action. But he simply spoke the word. He didn't go in there and try and resuscitate the body. He spoke the word creatively, and Lazarus came back. His spirit came back into his body. We need to speak with authority. You don't need to shout and scream. In fact, if you've got the authority, you definitely don't need to. If you have to shout and scream, I'm not sure you've got the authority. Okay? I've done deliverance in the supermarket aisle. Not too many people knew about it, just two people and God. Some of the most effective deliverance I've done, there were others around, they didn't need to know. It's on a need-to-know basis, you know? It's personal sometimes. And I can say it in a whisper, and you know what? Deaf and dumb spirits aren't deaf nor dumb. They may cause it, but they're not it. Okay, so you don't need to shout and scream. I heard one church, the pastor wanted the music cranked up so loud it was painful for everyone. But he said the demons don't like it. Actually, I think the demons caused it. Anointing and volume have no comparison. Okay, the third ingredient, faith in action. Peter lifted the man up. He did something. And then the man responded because he received strength in his legs and feet. I remember praying for a man in the Assembly of God Church in Surfers Paradise in Australia. He was so tall I couldn't reach his head to put my hand on it. And I was already on the first step. He was a very tall man. And I said, what do you need from the Lord? And he said, two things. He said, I've got a frozen shoulder. He said, I've got very little movement in my shoulder. And he said, and a few months ago I had surgery in my abdomen and they severed a nerve and I've got no feeling in my tummy. I can only imagine what that might feel like, but I never experienced it. So I said, oh, well, let's go for a warrant of fitness job, eh? So we dealt with a little issue that he needed to before the Lord, and I laid hands on his shoulder because it was all I could reach. I'm perfect for my height, I just couldn't reach him. I said, well, okay. I commanded his shoulder to unfreeze. And I said, start moving it. So he began to move it, and he moved it more and more, and then he was swinging it right round, and then he had a startled look on his face. And I said, what's happening? He said, I can feel my tummy. Do you know the Holy Spirit just knitted all his nerves back together again, just like that? Because he was obedient in acting in faith on his arm. Okay, I've seen that happen a number of times, not exactly like that, but that's an example where God says, if you're going to step out in faith, I will give you all the things you require. Okay, so get people to do something. Don't offer to go and play tennis with them. If they've got a bad back, that's probably not wise. A little bit of wisdom goes a long way. Now, Jesus worked with people at different levels of faith, and so will we, but five people with no faith is still nothing. Okay, and the reason I put this in here is Jesus in Mark, in the book of Mark, actually dragged a man out of town in order to heal him because he said there's unbelief here. Now, on a small number of occasions, I've had to do that, not drag him out of town, but I'll just sense this real unbelief. It's going to block a healing here. And on occasions, when the Lord prompts me about this, I will simply say, is there someone here who really doesn't believe God can heal this person? And usually there'll be somebody say, I wouldn't believe it if I saw it. I say, well, that's fine. We're here for them, not for you. Would you be kind enough? Step outside and you can come back and see the miracle later and then we'll talk about it. And so they leave the room. God heals them and then we bring them in and they can't argue with it because they've just seen the before and after. Okay, so if there's unbelief, put them away. Put them out of the road so that they actually don't have any influence on it. Because we're here for the person who's got the need, don't we? Aren't we? Now, if you've got a Goliath to deal with when you've got a lion-level faith, you know what I'm talking about here. David dealt with lions and then bars, and then he was ready for a Goliath. If you're dealing with something life-threatening like cancer, and you're only up to healing sprained fingers, then you need to take a giant killer with you. Somebody who's already got the track record of dealing with this stuff. Okay? Because you'll grow into being a giant killer in God's good time. Don't worry about it, because we're like trees. We grow or we die one day at a time. Okay? So if you're not growing, think of the alternative. It's called a chainsaw. Okay? I'm always intrigued. I just read a book earlier this month when I was on a plane back from Africa, and I had plenty of time to read, so I brought a book with me about Goliath's brothers. Did you know four of them are named in the scripture? Sorry, three of the four other brothers are named in scripture. Very interesting reading about what they were and what they did, and really quite exciting to read it. That's why David took five stones with him, because if his brothers turned up, he wanted to make sure they got rocked to sleep as well. Okay, let's just summarize the key ingredients that we've been looking through. How are we going for time? We're not doing too bad. Preaching the gospel, laying hands on the sick, allow a recovery time, allow the Holy Spirit to work through us. Sorry for the American spelling, I was trying to save room, but it didn't work. Use the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Use his proper name. Command with authority. Do you know that nowhere in the book of Acts onward did they pray for healing? They commanded healing because we have the authority to do that. Okay? So when you're ministering in healing, the first thing I usually say, Lord, is it your will to heal? And he'll usually say yes or no. One or the other, not both. Okay? Now, I can remember I was... brought a man with five kinds of cancer in 5 weeks to live, according to his doctor. His daughter and son-in-law brought this man to me. You know what to do in a time like that? You say, help, Lord, what do you want to do? It's very simple. You just do what he says. And he said, it's his time to come home, but you can pray for pain relief. You can pray for enough strength and energy to put his affairs in order, and when the time is right for him to come home, then the family have to let him go. And I spoke this out. Now, I actually asked the Holy Spirit, you show him what you show me. And he nodded each time as I said each part. And he said, that's exactly what he told me. See, that takes the heat out of it, because the Holy Spirit's told him before I've spoken the words. It takes the stress out of it. Now, his daughter didn't really like to hear that, but you know what? She testified at his funeral 10 weeks later that he was pain-free right to the end. And big Maori family, and I said to them, you don't need to wait for the funeral, for the tangi. Why don't you have a big celebration while you've still got him with you? And so they gathered all the whānau together and they had a big shindig while he was still well enough to enjoy the grandchildren and stuff like that. I'm so glad that we can say that to people and for them to act on it, okay? And put some faith in action. Okay, some people use a little prayer like this. Holy Spirit, I release your healing power right now. Be healed and made whole in the name of Jesus Christ. See, the first part is inviting the Holy Spirit. The second part is the command to be healed. Now, sometimes, and some of you who I ministered with last night will have heard me say something like, I command every cell in your body to come into divine order in the name of Jesus Christ. That's something I've picked up. It's just, I don't have all the words written out by rote so that I parrot them off. Usually, I want to get the spirit of what God wants to do. And I think that's more helpful. What else have we got here? Oh, yes. Yes, I do need to address that, just briefly. Two main causes of sickness and physical affliction. One is physical impairment. It can be an accident. It could be any range of things. Sometimes it's a hereditary thing. But usually if... Now, let me just say this. Sometimes in the Gospels, you'll see it says, Jesus rebuked the fever. Wherever you see the word rebuke used in that context, it was always a demon. Okay? Jesus never rebuked an illness. He rebuked a spirit that caused an illness. So that's just something to file away there. I don't really want to spend time looking at issues to do with demonic stuff. We've got a book and some DVDs on dealing with demons there, so I'm not going to spend time on that today. Can non-Christians be healed? I believe the answer is yes. The compassion, the love of God should get you to do this. And then you do the follow-up. I met a man who's an Anglican vicar from Singapore. He's now in Surabaya in Indonesia, the last place I knew. He went in when everybody else was leaving town because they just burnt down 2,000 churches 1 month, the Muslims had. And I won't tell you his whole story because it's an absolute miracle. Him and his wife went in because God said, and they knew it was a place of jeopardy. Literally within 3 days of arriving, he had 240 people in the kingdom. God was in it. I mean, through stuff. He taught them how to do this sort of thing in one sense. I met him a couple of years ago. Can't remember his name offhand. Doesn't matter, perhaps. But it was very interesting what he said. One of the ladies in their church, a young woman in her early 20s, and she saw that she really needed to go back to her home village. And she did that, and she turned up early in the morning at the village chief's place and made him a cup of coffee and took care of his needs. And I mean, they tend to do that in that sort of culture. And she was known to the village chief. And he said, what are you doing this for? And she said, because of Jesus, because of Isa. She said, I've come to serve you. And he said, oh, I've got servants, I don't need it. But she said, my brother lives over in such and such a village. His wife's dying of cancer. If you want to go and serve anybody, go and serve them. So she goes over there the very next morning. She walks through the jungle in the night to get there first at daybreak. And she knocks on the door and the man answers and she says why she's there and his brother has sent her. And so he shows her into where a very emaciated woman is lying on a little mattress on the floor. And she opens the curtains to let a little bit of light in and she says there's a smell of death in the place. Really bad. Cancer can be like that. And the man said to her before she did anything, because she was going to give her a bit of a wash and just try and freshen her up, he said, if she dies, I'm going to come and kill you. Do you know how to pray when somebody's just said that and probably got the capacity? So she just ministered the love of Jesus, prayed a healing prayer and thought, well, if I'm going to die, I might as well go home. So she left before the end of the day and went home. First thing, daylight the next morning, there's a knock on her door and here's the man and she thinks, Lord, I'm coming home. And she says, what can I do for you? And he said, you better come back. My wife is up serving me. She's well, totally healed. You better come and tell us about this Isa of yours. You see, sometimes we've missed something because we're too religious. There's an example from somebody who was that was part of their church. Okay, so I don't care whether they're born again or not. That's irrelevant for the ministry of healing, but we do that follow-up as an appropriate thing afterwards. Should you throw your medicine away? I've sort of mentioned this. I don't think I need to go through it again. Be careful with terminal cases. Do not give false hope. I remember speaking, I won't identify the church, but I remember speaking with a pastor once in our city. Anne and I and half a dozen other couples got together for a barbecue, and we hadn't all seen each other for quite a while. And our host and hostess just bought this new house, and so we're having this lovely barbecue there. And everybody else went outside to look at the gardens, and I was left inside in the lounge with this pastor, and I think God arranged it. And I just said to him, oh, do you have a good healing team in your church right now? And he sort of was a bit uncomfortable with that, but I felt the Holy Spirit was nudging, so I just kept going. Sometimes it pays to be a little brutal, because there's usually results if you're sure that it's the Lord, not just rudeness. And I said, oh, I remember preaching in your church 3 times before they called you as the pastor. And they had a really on-fire healing team then. A lot of ministry was done, a lot of people healed. And he still looked uncomfortable. And then the Holy Spirit dropped in what the key was. And I said, is it possible? Because I'd sort of said, is this just where everybody's got tired and you've laid the ministry down in the church for a little while, for a season? And he said, oh no, it's nothing like that. But he was really not responsive. But I think God wanted to put his finger on something. And I said, has it anything to do with the way you were treated when your first wife was dying of cancer? Bingo. And he had a little weep. That's why the Lord took the rest out of the room, I think. And when he regained his composure, he said, you wouldn't believe the number of Christians who would go into the hospital room and slap oil on my wife without asking her and would tell her to get out of bed because she's healed. He said, if I didn't have a strong faith, I wouldn't have survived. He said, she died. But he said, I've lost all our children because of the sin of presumption of all these people who didn't bother to check with God what his will was. We need to be very, very sensitive with people who are dealing with terminal illness. Let me say it again. It's always good to pray for pain relief. If the Lord is willing to heal a seriously or terminally ill person, I suggest they go and check out with 2 mature Christians, perhaps their pastor and elders or something, depends on who it is, but don't act until you've got 3 in agreement, because there's a power in unity, and besides, they can bail you out if you get arrested. Okay? Don't forget, God is sovereign. I've said this already this weekend. I'm not going to apologize for the sovereignty of God. I can't. Because sometimes we don't get shown what he wants in the long term. Because you know the ultimate healing is to be with him, not to walk around for another 10 years. Okay? It's the prerogative of God. Sometimes it's a timing issue. And just remember to be patient because God's in charge. That's important for us to remember. That's why I said the other day, can't remember, it was upstairs, you're never going to hear oops in heaven. Okay? So where do we do this ministry? Well, it might be at one of your chapter meetings, it might be at the front of a church. Those are sort of more what I would call first aid things or simple things. But the priority should be, as I've already explained, seek God's will for their situation. And if the Lord indicates he's not going to heal, then don't say the wrong thing. I'd like you to remember your head. You have two ears, two eyes, and one mouth. Use them in proportion. Look and listen a lot more than you say. Okay? And false healings. I'm reasonably well known for addressing this issue in places. There are all sorts of witch doctors, and they hide even under the name of Christian therapists sometimes. Find out what sort of Christian. A lot of spiritualism. I'm tempted, I haven't quite got the time to do it, because I know it would take quite a bit of doing, but we're tempted to put an ad in our local paper inviting all the people who have been for spiritualist healing to come and have the demon removed and get healed properly. Any of you want a challenge sometime, let me know when you can come. Because when we do this, I believe we're going to see something quite significant happen. Okay. Third healing recipe. Normally in the manual, the third one is dealing with demons, but I'm not going to go there today. I mentioned this scripture yesterday, I think. 1 Corinthians, there it is, 12:9. Gifts of healing. Plural. Let me say this about healing. The gift of healing usually operates with gifts of faith and miracles. And quite often when I'm laying hands on for the Holy Spirit to impart a gift of healing, not always, but sometimes the Lord says, I want to give them this gift as well, and I'll just speak it out. Now, I can't give it. It's God's to give. I just do the facilitation, I guess, for this. And the gift of healing operates successfully without faith. Now, let me ask you this question. Should all of us be sharing our faith with other people? True? Okay? And yet there are evangelists who can speak a very ordinary word and hundreds of people get saved. See, there's the every believer and there's the office. You see, there's a difference that operates at a whole different level. I believe healing is like that. All believers should be healing the sick, but there is a gift of healing that seems to imply an act of faith that everybody else has given up on. I don't really understand the dynamics of it. I've just seen it happen so many times. Sometimes the sick person has no faith left. They've been drained of everything that they thought they had to be well. They've gone to all sorts of quacks and stuff. They've tried all sorts of remedies and therapies, and yet they're not better. In fact, usually they're worse. In fact, I like preaching from Mark chapter 5 on that one. See, a lot of people healed because they hear God's word and they get healed just watching. Anyway, the gift of healing operates where you speak it out and it happens when an ordinary believer will come along and nothing seems to happen. I don't really understand why God does it, but then I don't understand a lot of things about God. I need to finish with this statement. Or very close to finished. Christianity is a miracle religion. Without miracles, we wouldn't be here. I think we understand that. Jesus healed lots of people. He raised 3 from the dead. And most disturbing for some in the church these days, he's commanded his disciples to do the same. Like I started with on the very first session that I addressed on Thursday afternoon, when Jesus established the church, how did I word it? Paganism ruled the empire and religion paralyzed the church, paralyzed the religious people. The only difference between then and now is there are more disciples. So we should be making a lot more difference than we are. And I want to challenge every one of us to lift our game in the area of healing evangelism, because I believe it's one of the better tools that God's given us. And we've got people who say, well, we don't do that in our church. Well, I have a friend in America. He was told that very thing, and he told me how he answered it, and I said, I like that. I'm going to use that. Do you know what he said? Somebody said, oh, we don't do that in our church. And he said, well, I happen to know the head of your denomination, and he told me it's okay. And they said, you know, And they rattled this person's name off, and he said, "No, I know Jesus, and if he's not head of your church, you need to find a new one." Okay. The level of faith you may have is not the determining factor in healing or miracles. And please don't be tied to formulas or rituals or rules. That's just the foundation of religion. Faith doesn't determine whether we need medicine or not, because God can use doctors. I can think of one man, I read his testimony of his ministry some years ago, and he got a rhema word for a man in his church in a leadership role and instantly healed, in spite of lots of prayer before, of a heart condition. He was scheduled for surgery the next day for a quadruple bypass. But you know what? 2 years later, the pastor needed to have the quadruple bypass. And he said, "Lord, why did I have to go through that?" And he said, "Because I needed one miracle for him and you didn't need one. I'm happy to use a doctor for you." See, we need not to be in fighting with the medical people. Okay? God can use them too. Luke was a doctor. Jesus said, if you're sick, reach for a doctor. Okay? Don't forget to ring up the elders as well. I remember one time, I was a bit newer at this than I am now, lived in Oamaru. I won't identify the people, it wouldn't be fair, because I haven't asked their permission and they probably don't know I'm saying this. But we had a man in our church. Our pastor had died and I ended up being the senior elder, not by any choice of mine. And this man fell off a second floor roof and really wrecked his back quite badly. And I got the phone call to gather the elders and go up to the hospital and anoint him with oil. And when we got there, I was asking the Lord on the way up the hospital hill when it was in the old place. I said, "Lord, what do you want to do?" And he said, "I've been trying to get his attention for ages. Don't you heal him now?" I'm thinking, that wasn't what I was expecting to hear. So I just kept my peace until we got there and all the elders gathered around his bed and we pulled the curtain around so we had some privacy. And here he is busy saying, "I believe God can bring me out of this bed." And I thought, I've got to say it. And I looked at the other elders across the bed and I said, "Well, I believe God can too, but that's not his will." And I told them what had happened. And the elders all nodded their heads simultaneously, which was a huge sigh of relief. We prayed for pain relief, but you know what? He had 6 months on his back. Well, his back was repaired by God a slow way. And he's a much nicer guy now. I've stayed in his home since then. He wasn't such a nice guy then. He was a bit prideful and a few other problems. And I'm not speaking out of turn, but I'm not going to name him either, because that wouldn't be fair. But you see, sometimes God has a different agenda. And we need a little bit of wisdom and discernment about what we should do. Let me come back to one scripture I said before. And I've got one other after this. "I'm the vine," Jesus said, "you're the branches. You abide in me and I in him in you. You'll bear much fruit. Without me you can do nothing." You can't do a thing. And Jesus is the same yesterday, today and forever. And so he healed, he still heals, and he will heal until he no longer needs to. I want to pray. Some people wanted the email web address. There it is. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, I want to bless you for our time here this weekend. Lord, I'm mindful this is my last speaking opportunity, and I just want to say, Father, it's been a privilege to be here. Lord, there's faith in the house. And I believe you can and will do many things through many of us, as many as will allow you to use us. And so, Father, I ask that your grace would be upon us. Lord, we don't deserve your grace, but thank you for it anyway. We don't deserve your mercy, but thank you for it anyway. But, Father, I ask that your grace and mercy would come upon every one of us, right where we sit in this place today, that we would know the presence of your Holy Spirit in a measure like we've never known before. And Father, I pray blessing on each and every one here. Lord, even some who have had to take off for the airport and other places. Father, bless each one of us that's been here these last few days. Let us know a fresh infilling, a refreshing of the waters of your word in our spirits. Lord, especially for Graham and for the leadership team of Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International in New Zealand. And Lord, give them a new name, a shorter one. Please. But Father, give them wisdom as they give leadership to the different chapters. And Lord, even the other ministries that sort of look to them in any way for any sort of leadership, the influence that we have. Father, I pray too your wisdom and your blessing and your empowerment to my brother Mark and to Martha for their ministry up in Warkworth and wherever you take them. And Lord, for each one of us, Father, that your Holy Spirit would go with us and that signs would follow us wherever you call us to go. And Father, whether it's in our chapter meetings, whether it's in our churches or our homes or our workplaces or wherever it is, Lord, Holy Spirit, just quicken us for the people that we should say, would you like me to pray for your healing? And then, Lord, give us the strategy to see them healed on the spot. And Lord, let us not be presumptuous, but Father, I pray that the miraculous becomes a way of life for every one of us, in order that Jesus Christ be glorified. Oh Lord, just bless us. In fact, Lord, to use what Dr. Reddick's going to teach coming over the coming month around New Zealand, I bless each one of you in the name of the Lord, in the authority he gives me to bless you in your life, in your ministry, every one of you, regardless of where you're from, where you're going is far more important. So, Father, I bless you for the opportunity to minister with this bunch of guys and gals who just want to see New Zealand brought into fully into your kingdom in order that Jesus truly be King of New Zealand. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to hand back to Mike in a moment, but I'm mindful that we've got a session starting at 7, I think it is. And Mark's going to be speaking, and we need to go and get some food before the town runs out. I wonder if there are some who, when I was talking about the gift of healing, this will be the symptom that this is relating to you. When I talked about the gift of healing, the third one on the list, you remember the third recipe. If you believe that you're meant to receive the laying on of hands for a gift of healing, I'm going to invite you to come out so we can do just that. It'll be very brief. Has anybody got any oil? I've left mine at home for some reason, which is really serious. All I feel to do is to anoint your hands. And I remember all those years ago, and I think you were there, Graham, at the Taradale Town Hall. Somebody told me they were there. It must be a good 10 years ago in the Taradale Town Hall. And I remember that this is the first time the Lord ever said for me to do this about 10 years ago. He said, tell them that when I spoke about the gift of healing, their heart rate went up. That's the sign that they are to come to receive a gift of healing through the laying on of hands. And 60 people came forward out of the 400 odd people that were there. And Leonie, the pastor's wife, said to me, do you know anybody here? This was after the evening was finished. And I said, I knew three people. I didn't know anybody else. And she said, did you know that most of the people who came forward were nurses? I said, who's running the hospital? But do you know what? As I went along and just anointed the hands, often the Lord would give me a little word for them, word of encouragement. And I anointed one lady's hands, and the Lord said, say this, these hands will be laid on the dead and they'll arise. I thought, ooh, spooky. And then about six ladies further on, it was almost all women. There was only a handful of guys amongst the whole bunch of them. Six people further on, the Lord said, say it again. And I said it. And Leonie was following me along the row as my sort of witness of what I was saying. And I never remember it afterwards. So it's helpful to have somebody with a good memory. Just don't get people with dementia. They get it wrong. Anyway, And she says, do you remember praying for two people and you said they'd lay hands on the dead and they'll arise? And I said, yes, I remember that. Couldn't point you out who they were. And she said, both of those are nurses and they work in accident and emergency. It would be real useful. See, God knows. We don't know. I was flying blind. I told Pastor Ken afterwards about, I said, I've never done this before. And he said, doesn't matter. You were obedient and look what God's done. So I expect the Hawke's Bay is a very healthy place now. We've got a lot of people with a healing gift there. Is it true?
Yeah.
Oh, Paul thinks so. He's from there. Well, you're from that church, so were you there that night? Is it as I said? It's always good to have a confirmation. Anyway, I'll hand back to Mike, but if you want to do that, then I think it would be good for us to... I won't turn this off because somebody wanted something, so... Thank you, Mike.